ago he blessed the earth, born older than the years. And in the stall a cross he saw, through the first of many tears. A life of homeless wandering, cast out in sorrow's way. The shepherd seeking for the lost, his life the price he paid. Love crucified arose, the risen one in splendor, Jehovah's sole defender, has won the victory. Love crucified arose, and the grave became a place of hope, for the heart that sin and sorrow broke is beating once again. Throughout your life you felt the weight of what you'd come to give, to drink for us that crimson cup so we might really live. At last the time to love and die, the dark appointed day, that one forsaken moment when your father turned his face away. One crucified arose, the one who lived and died for me, was Satan's nail-pierced casualty, now he's breathing once again. Love crucified arose, and the grave became a place of hope, for the heart that sin and sorrow broke is beating once again. Love crucified arose, the risen one in splendor, Jehovah's sole defender, has won the victory. Love crucified arose, and the grave became a place of hope, for the heart that sin and sorrow broke is beating once again. It's beating once again.
Thanks to my sweetie again for singing. We're still longing to meet together, but thankfully we have today to be reminded to celebrate again the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. I don't know how well the sound projected last week, but I'm going to remind everybody that of the church family, particularly, that if you want to send in what you would normally be giving, send it either to Box 236 here in Fairmount, which is the church's address, or Ashley will take it, sending it to Box 144. Let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter 24. Sometimes the fact that Luke doesn't include a lot of detail is bypassed, but we're going to look at Luke chapter 24, looking at the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. We're going to pray and then look into Scripture. Father, thank you that we have your word open before us and we have your Spirit to illuminate us. Do so at this time. Father, use what you would to deal in our hearts. And God, we want to thank you for the abundance of mercies you've been displaying on vast numbers of people. We ask right now that you would work as you see fit. And Father, if there be anyone without Christ who may be listening to this today, may your Holy Spirit bring them to the saving knowledge of Christ. In Jesus' name we ask you. Amen. First thing we're going to notice here about Luke chapter 24 is the time of the resurrection, and notice it says, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. All the gospel writers include the fact that it's the first day of the week, and it's an important mention because not only, well, first of all, it confirms that Jesus had been dead and brought himself to life as he said he would. Over in John chapter 10, and take your Bible, follow along please. In John chapter 10, in verse 18, our Lord has said, no man takes it from me, that is his life. No man takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. There was a belief that was common that after a person's body was dead, that the spirit would hover for 3 days and then depart. Well, at any extent, the Lord Jesus prophesied 3 days. It's interesting to note, and I'm going to mention these places in Matthew, but then we want to read one in Luke. Matthew has five mentions in which the Lord Jesus himself prophesied of his resurrection. If you want to write these, Matthew 12, 40, Matthew chapter 16 and verse 21, Matthew chapter 17, verses 22 and 23, Matthew chapter 20, verses 17 to 19, Matthew chapter 26, verses 31 and 32. But I want us to look back at what the Lord says. Luke chapter 18, we'll notice at verse 31. Luke writes, and he says, then he took unto him the 12 and said to them, behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and all the things that are written by the prophets concerning the Son of Man shall be accomplished. For he shall be delivered to the Gentiles, and shall be mocked, and spitefully treated, and spit on. They will scourge him, and put him to death, and the third day he shall rise again. This is Jesus' own prophecy. A further importance about the time of the resurrection harkens us back to Old Testament prophecies. And first of all, go to Psalm chapter 16. Psalm chapter 16 and verse 9, David writes, therefore my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also shall rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Sheol, neither will you permit your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Look in Acts chapter 2. And in verse 25, on this mighty message that Peter preached, Acts chapter 2 and verse 25, Peter is presenting the resurrected Christ, and he says, for David speaks concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he's on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad, and moreover my flesh shall also rest in hope, because you will not leave my soul in Hades, neither will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You've made known to me the ways of life. You shall make me full of joy with your countenance. Skip to verse 31, and Peter brings about a summation of this. He, seeing this before, spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in Hades, neither his flesh did see corruption. This Jesus has God raised up, whereof we all are witnesses. look at Psalm 118. Just another place in prophesying the resurrection of Christ. Psalm 118 and verse 22. The stone which the builders refused has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We find this reference in Acts chapter 4, in verse 10, where Peter and John are dealing with the Jewish leaders. Peter says, "Be it known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand before you well. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved." Just a couple of Old Testament prophecies. Now, another importance, going back to our text, another importance of the time of the resurrection has to do with the fact that it became significant in the gathering of the people in the early church. Once again, we can find over in Acts chapter 20, in verse 7, on one of Paul's missionary journeys, says in verse 6, "We sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread and came to them in Troas in 5 days, for we abode 7 days. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the next day, and continued his speech till midnight." Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 2, where Paul's encouraging the Corinthians about their giving and all the guidelines that he lays out there, but he tells them, bring it on the first day of the week. So the time of the resurrection has a lot of importance. Notice we see in Luke chapter 24 and verse 1, the site of the resurrection. They came to the sepulcher, bringing the spices they had prepared. All the Gospels emphasize the sepulcher for a reason. There was no mistake about where they were to be. Now, look at Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27, skip clear to verse 57. When the evening was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed. And there were Mary Magdalene and the other Mary sitting over against the sepulcher. It tells us in the last two verses of Matthew 27 that Pilate had set up a guard, a watch over those people. Now, the sepulcher being the site of the resurrection, reading what we read in Matthew about Joseph of Arimathea, challenges us to a very important lesson, because notice, Joseph took something that was the very best he had to offer in the burial of our Lord Jesus, but he freely gave it of his own. In like manner, we need to seek to faithfully serve the Lord Jesus in the capacity he gives us, y'all. We aren't expected to be the very best one at everything that we do. We aren't supposed to necessarily plan to be the most knowledgeable of anything. We aren't. That isn't our objective, is knowing the Lord as Savior, but it is to seek to serve Him in the best capacity that we have with the opportunities that come our way. And I want us to look at a portion to challenge us like this. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and it's something that Paul writes. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. And then Paul says, but with me it's a very small thing that I should be judged of you or of man's judgment. Yea, I judge not my own self, for I know nothing against myself, yet am I not hereby justified, but he that judges me is the Lord. Paul did not direct his ministering according to public opinion, verse 3. Verse 4, he didn't adjust his ministering just to achieve results. Verse 3 wasn't dependent upon public opinion. He says, I'm not concerned if I'm going to be judged of you or of any man's judgment. I don't even look at myself. It's not the popular opinion. It's not according to results that we serve the Lord Jesus. It's according to Scripture we make the choices that we do in a life that's set apart to serve our Lord. Well, this is what Joseph of Arimathea did when he took the best that he had to offer in burying the Lord Jesus. Back to our text. In verse 2, it's going to bring to mind the fact that there were some barriers, put that in quotes, there were barriers to the resurrection. And the first thing that we learn here in Luke's account is that there was a stone. It was rolled away from the sepulchre, but Mark chapter 16 and verse 4 tells us that the stone was very great. Matthew indicates that it was very great. Now, it's interesting to learn, but it's very likely that this tomb in which Joseph buried our Lord Jesus may well have had multiple compartments. It could have been structured like a mausoleum, as we would understand it, so that Joseph is placing the Lord Jesus in one of those sections. It's very possible, as we study and learn, that it was structured that way. So when Mark tells us the stone was very great, he knew what he was talking about. It would have been a very, very large stone rolled over the mouth of that tomb. So much so that Matthew chapter 28 and verse 2 tells us that it took an angel to remove the stone. Now, we know that as the women approached this, and Luke doesn't indicate here, but as the women approached the sepulcher, they were unaware of who was going to remove it. They knew there was a stone, but who was going to remove it, they didn't know. They didn't realize that an angel was at work. And an angel, we are told, is responsible for removing the stone. Think about the importance of angels in the life of God's people, being ministering spirits to those who are the heirs of salvation. It tells us that, if you want to make a note of it and look at it, Hebrews chapter 1, verses 13 and 14, that the angels are set aside to minister to us. Now, I don't know if everybody has their own guardian angel or if the angels are just dispatched as the Lord sees fit to tend to us, but a lot of us, most of us, if not all of us listening to this, can think of many times where that we've realized our guardian angel was working overtime. But think about some of the other barriers that we learn in the Gospels that were confronting the resurrection. There was the Roman guard. There, John chapter 20, John teaches us about the grave clothes. Look at Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, verse 14. Matthew chapter 26 and verse 14. Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went into the chief priest, said to them, "What will you give me, and I will deliver him to you?" And they bargained with him for 30 pieces of silver, and from that time he sought opportunity to betray him. There was the plot by the Jewish leaders with Judas. Later on in Matthew chapter 27, at the end of the chapter, there was the plot that the Jewish leaders contrived with Pilate when they went in and said, "Well, we're afraid somebody's going to take him and try to steal him and say he's been resurrected." And Pilate said, "You have a watch." He gave some Roman soldiers to protect the tomb. Some of these were barriers. There was the thing that Scripture gives us is most despicable, though, is Judas. Matthew chapter 26 and verse 24. Look at what the Lord says. Here they are at the Last Supper. Matthew chapter 26 and verse 24. "The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born." Judgment was going to fall upon Judas, and forever we know him to be called the son of perdition. Now we can look at Judas, we can look at these Jewish leaders, we can look at Pilate. Y'all, let's be reminded that we are taught in Scripture that our sin put the Lord Jesus on the cross. The sin of the world sent Christ to the cross. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Paul says, "For what one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned." Back in chapter 3 of Romans, we learn in a phrase, "For all have sinned and come short of God's glory." It tells us in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 and 15, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." Our sin sent Christ to the cross, and he's the one who paid the price to defeat death. We'll come back to our text. We're going to see some indicators of the resurrection, or evidences, if you wish. Verse 2 in Luke chapter 24 tells us that the stone was rolled away. Verse 3 tells us they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. If we look at Matthew chapter 28, we learn that there was an earthquake so tremendous that the Roman soldiers fainted from terror. And consider those soldiers as we think what Matthew teaches us in Matthew chapter 28. These soldiers, perhaps some of these very ones who were sent to guard the tomb were of those who gave such cruel and brutal treatment to the Lord Jesus. These may have been some of those who were present at the foot of the cross when in the peak of the day, the sky turned black. And there was an earthquake then. They were undoubtedly part of the group who heard their own centurion say, "Truly, this was the Son of God." And here they are guarding this tomb, and now this happens. There doesn't take much speculation to realize that these Roman soldiers were sure they were falling to some sort of judgment. Something to learn about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I'm speaking now to anybody who may be watching this who doesn't know Christ as Savior. Jesus' resurrection assures that judgment is going to fall on those who do not know Christ as Savior someday. I'm going to the book of John, chapter 3. John chapter 3, verse 16, lots of people can quote this verse, even people who don't know Christ as Savior. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." It's great to talk about God's love. But let's not forget that John finishes the third chapter of his gospel by saying this in verse 36, "He that believes on the Son has everlasting life, and that he that believes not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him." Now we're tying this to the resurrection, so I'd like you to turn to Acts chapter 17. In Acts chapter 17, we find Paul in the city of Athens. He's waiting for some of his companions to come to him to continue on ministry. And while he's there in Athens, he notices all the idols that are erected. But in verse 22, Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "You men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you're very religious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Whom therefore you ignorantly worship, him I declare to you." And Paul went on. And by the time he finishes, he preaches Christ. But I want us to notice something that he says. Skip to verse 30 here in Acts chapter 17. "The times of this ignorance God overlooked." Now that doesn't mean that he ignored how men thought and acted and everything else. But the idea of overlooked is to see beyond a certain point. God overlooked, but now he commands all men everywhere to repent. Now look here, y'all, "because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained, concerning which he has given assurance to all men that he has raised him from the dead." And of course, Paul is referencing the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ was raised from the dead. It was the most profound of testimonies as to who he was, what he came to accomplish. And it was a finished work. And Paul reminds these people that this resurrected Christ is the one who will judge people for their sins someday. I'm going to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 11. This is the rest of the story. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 11. John writes and says, I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. He goes on to say in verse 15, whoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. This is called the great white throne judgment. Someday, people who do not, every person who doesn't know Christ as Savior is going to stand before God at this time. Notice, books are open, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. The people who will stand at this great white throne judgment someday will not be found in the book of life. They will be examined according to all these other books. That is, the things they've done, their works. This won't save them. They will be cast into the lake of fire. Now perhaps, if you don't know Christ as Savior, God may be dealing with your heart right now. The best thing you can do is turn this off. Get before God, confess your sin, repent of your sin, turn to Christ and ask Him to come into your life and save you. That's the most important thing you can do. But we're talking about some of these barriers. Let's consider, some of these evidences of the resurrection. Matthew chapter 28, verse 66 tells us that the seal that Pilate had put on the tomb was broken. You see, no earthly ruler has more power than God. Fact is, we can go to Psalm 75 and we learn there that God sets rulers in place. God removes them. God sets kingdoms and empires in place, and God removes them. Now come back to our text in Luke chapter 24. We're going to observe the testimony of the angels as an evidence. It came to pass, as they were much perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments, and as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He's not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke unto you when he was yet in Galilee, and on they spoke. Now, Matthew chapter 28, Matthew tells us that in the sequence of events, there was one angel that spoke to them. There was one angel that rolled the stone away. By one angel's action, the Roman guard was terrified so much they fainted. One angel spoke to the women. Luke here tells us that they entered into the tomb to see Jesus wasn't there. Mark tells us there's one angel who speaks to them. And now Luke is telling us there were two. Notice the angels were appearing as men. Luke tells us that there were two speaking to the angels. What we want to observe is all they did was verify what has already been said. They didn't have a new message. They didn't do anything spectacular. It had already been done. And it's a great lesson for us. They didn't need to enhance anything or embellish what had already been said. See, the only means by which a person is going to be convinced to come to Jesus Christ to be saved is in the principle that we see right here about these angels. They didn't speak anything new. We simply have a gospel message to tell people about Christ. We can go to any person and say, God loves you so much that he sent Jesus to die for your sin. And through Jesus, you can be saved. That's our message. Fact is, we're here in Luke chapter 24. Look at verse 7, y'all. We didn't finish this thought. He's not here, but he's risen. Remember how he spoke unto you when he's yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. All that these angels do is convey what the Lord Jesus had already told them. Now, y'all look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians in chapter 15. Paul says, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you've received and in which you stand, by which also you're saved if you keep in memory what I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. I know I've said this to our church family different times, but y'all, if presenting Jesus Christ as the Savior of the world is not the sufficient message, we don't have anything else to tell people. We don't need to come up with gimmicks. We need to present Christ with our lives, with our lips. Take this principle from looking at how Paul approaches the Corinthians. I'm looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul wasn't concerned about fancy language, big $100 words and all that kind of thing. He wanted to simply present Christ. And y'all, we know good and well that Paul was a very, very educated man. Could have engaged them in all sorts of philosophical discussions. But he wanted to present Christ. Come back to our text. Well, before we do, I want to mention one thing about this. Notice verse 4. It came to pass as they were much perplexed about this, behold, the two men stood by them in shining garments. They were perplexed because they didn't have in mind the things that the Lord Jesus had said. They weren't focused on the truths of Scripture. We see some of this conduct in the disciples as well. The perplexity had to do with the fact that they weren't focused on the word. And notice the solution we find in verse 8. And they remembered his words. That's the solution to the perplexity. Now, I don't know what's going on in everybody's thinking today. I mean, y'all know good and well, I can't even read Swede's mind, much less anybody else's. But y'all, when we have times where we think we're confused about something, we're perplexed, we just don't know what's going to happen next, what's this world coming to, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, The best thing we can do is focus our attention on principles that were taught in the scripture and gauge our conduct in accordance with that. That takes care of perplexity. Now, the next point I want us to see, observing the benefits that accrued from the resurrection. Verse 8, they remembered his words. They returned from the sepulcher and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. The truths of Scripture became very real, very alive to them as suddenly they're putting two and two together. They're seeing that there's no one in that tomb, and they're being reminded, here's what you've been told. He is risen. Luke gives us the account of Jesus encountering the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Look at Luke chapter 24 and verse 31. As Jesus sits down to eat with them, their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, this is important, didn't our heart burn within us while he talked with us along the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? Look at verse 45. Jesus meets with all the disciples. Then he opened their understanding that they might understand the scriptures. And this is all post-resurrection. The power of the resurrection is at work in God bringing us to understand scripture. And hallelujah to the Lord. Thankfully, today, when we open scripture, if we come to understand anything, we know it's because the Spirit of God illuminates us, teaches us. Let's look at a couple of scriptures to illustrate this. I'm going, first of all, to John chapter 14. John chapter 14 and verse 26. Jesus says, the Comforter, who's the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I've said to you. That's talking about illumination. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, in part here, and we're in the middle of a large point, that a large paragraph, but Paul says, now we've received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who's of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. What things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Paul says later in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 14 and 15, that if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is vain, and your faith is vain, yea, and we're found false witnesses of God, because we testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. But Christ is risen from the dead, and the things which are taught, which are integral to our faith, are real, they're vital. Coming back to our text, another thing that we can observe is the power of the presence of the Lord Jesus, very tremendously emphasized. Verse 15, came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, this is the two Emmaus men walking together, Jesus drew near and went with them. He's making himself known to them, and they're not grasping who he is. But eventually, it's going to strike them. The real impact of the resurrected Lord. Verse 30, we read, and it came to pass as he sat eating with them, he took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. They understood the fellowship that they had with the Lord Jesus, the presence of the resurrected Savior. Think how it applies to us today amongst other principles we can see. Look at Matthew chapter 20. Matthew chapter 28, excuse me. Matthew chapter 28 and verse 20. This is the resurrected Lord. He's speaking at the time of his ascension. He says, verse 19, "Go therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Amen." In Acts, we read that the disciples had said, "Well, when are you going to set up your kingdom?" And they were told, "It's not for you to know." And here's the Lord Jesus leaving them with what we call the Great Commission. And it's all in the context of someone who died on the cross, was buried, and rose again, just like he said he would. If they had any question about the power that was involved in what he commissioned them to do, it was eliminated. So there was, thirdly, here in the benefit to those who follow the Lord Jesus is a, what we might say, a rekindling of their zeal to serve. Verse 9, after they remember his words, Luke chapter 24, verse 9, "And returned from the sepulchre and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest." And think of the scenes which we have reading further in Luke, like we've done, looking at the Emmaus disciples and their response. The rekindled zeal to serve the Lord Jesus. Amongst the disciples and others, there had been great sadness. There had been despair. There had been disbelief. They acted as though they had no hope, reading about the Emmaus disciples. They were discouraged. Now, they have a fresh perspective. They've got intense vitality. We serve a risen Savior. This may be an Easter in which our celebrating the Easter season takes on a different aura simply because of the nature of what's happening in our country right now. But y'all, it's a risen Savior we still serve. And it's his presence with us that will encourage us. I don't know if Josh and Mandy are taking this in, but I know that "He Lives" is a favorite hymn of Mandy's. So, Mandy, I had that in mind thinking about you. We serve a risen Savior. And I'm going to read what John records for us in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 18, where John in his revelation of Jesus Christ sees him and he hears this: "I am he that lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death." Seeing then we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us. And let us run with patience the race set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of God. Keep on keeping on, y'all, because we serve a risen Savior. And with that in mind, I want us to look at 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter reminds us that by resurrection power, we are kept. We are preserved to the end of what God has in store for us. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that fades not away, reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Now maybe a person doesn't know Christ as Savior. This Christ gave up his life on the cross willingly, voluntarily for you. He was crucified, he was buried, he rose again for you. And as we read in one of those portions of scripture in this message, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul says that is in part the gospel message. Because of Christ, the free gift of eternal life is offered to you. The question is this the day of your salvation? Let's have prayer. Father, we just ask you to use this word as you see fit. Thank you for the power of the scripture. Thank you for the Lord Jesus. Thank you, God, that he went to the cross, bearing the payment for our sin in his own body on the tree. Father, thank you that the free gift of eternal life is offered to all. May we who know Christ gladly serve him for Jesus' sake. Amen.